Now we are ready to start the synthesis process, and this is step one, in which we're going to develop the low-pass prototype filter. So we're going to begin with a lumped element filter, and here we have a pi arrangement with two shunt capacitors and one series inductor, and we're going to calculate the element values. In the entire synthesis process, we're going to turn each of those elements into either a series LC or a parallel LC, and eventually we're going to make everything into parallel LCs so that we can use shorted stubs. Now this is the response of a sixth order Chebyshev filter, and it's easy for us to see multiple ripples, and that's why I picked this rather than the third order response. Epsilon here is called the ripple factor, so it's important that we get these terms right. Another factor that we use is the passband ripple, usually expressed as just PBR, which is equal to 1 plus epsilon squared. And the ripple in dB is just 10 log of PBR. So when people express ripple, they will usually either use the ripple in decibels or they will talk about the ripple factor. At the corner frequency, and this corner frequency is omega zero, and that's where that big red dot is, at that corner frequency, our response will be down by the ripple. And we're plotting the square of the transmission response, so we're talking about power. This ripple factor, here we start being down by the ripple, and then we go up to a perfect transmission in the passband, so we're not including loss in our circuit. We come down by the ripple amount, then we go back up to a perfect transmission, and then we come down again, and then we go up, and then we have a very steep skirt, which is the characteristic of Chebyshev. Now if we look at the opposite of transmission, which is reflection, so here is the reflection squared again, we'll see that wherever we have a lull in our transmission response, we'll have a peak in the reflected response, because no energy is being absorbed within our filter, since we're dealing simply with perfect L's and C's at this stage, and there's no loss inside the filter. So we can track the ripples by looking at the transmission response, or we can track them by looking at the reflection response. This point here is called a pole in the transmission response, and it is a zero in the reflection response. So when people talk about the poles of a filter, you need to be careful as to what they're talking about, because the poles in the transmission response are the zeros in the reflection response, just as the poles in the reflection response are the zeros in the transmission response. Now the reason why that is important is that when we look at the characteristic of a filter, we usually think of what's in the passband, but during design, we tend to focus more on the reflection response. And again, when we're at the corner frequency, we are down by the ripple amount. If we want steeper filter skirts, we can achieve that by either having a higher order filter or having a large ripple. Generally, we pick the ripple to be reasonably small, and a ripple factor of 0.1 is fairly small, that's about 0.04 dB, but even a ripple of 0.1 dB would be fairly acceptable. And that is because if we have loss in our filter, even a very small amount of loss, a ripple that's around about 0.1 dB with a typical microstrip filter is going to be completely smoothed out because of the loss. So in band, it is going to look as though we have a Butterworth type of response. It's going to look very flat. However, we still achieve the very steep filter skirts of a Chebyshev filter. There are a number of ways we can come up with the element values of a filter. What are shown here are the coefficients of a third order Chebyshev filter. Traditionally, these are normalized to a radian quarter frequency of 1 radian per second and a 1 ohm system impedance. And we translate or transform our filter to whatever other value of system impedance or corner frequency that we want. Now with this filter, we were given the fact that we needed a ripple factor of 0.1. So epsilon is equal to 0.1, and this is a ripple of 0.0432 dB. And from the table, we pick off that rightmost column there. So typically, many of our filters can be developed by looking at tables. There are a number of standard values that are presented. Now, just to reinforce this, omega zero is the radian frequency at which the transmission response of the filter is down by the ripple. Well, here omega zero is equal to 1 radian per second. Sometimes you will come across filter tables where the normalization could be 1 hertz. If that was the case, then a lot of the development that's going to follow in this case study would have to change just a little bit. So in this case study, we're going to take the corner frequency of the low-pass prototype filter as 1 radian per second. We take the G values from this table. So we have G1, G2, and G3. Here is our filter. Now it turns out that this element here is G0. And even though it is not listed in the table, G0 and also Gn plus 1, which is G4 here, because we're dealing with a third order filter, are just referring to the input and output resistances. And G1 is the numerical value of our first element, G2 is the numerical value of the center element, and G3 is the numerical value of the final element. And this is a symmetrical filter. We have 50 ohm impedances on both sides. The whole layout looks symmetrical. So G1 is equal to G3. So G1 is the numerical value of C11. C11 comes out to be 0.85158 farads. L21 is a very large inductance, and C31 is a very large capacitance as well. But of course, our corner frequency is 1 radian per second, so it's not surprising these values are so large. Now, sometimes the type of filter we want is not listed in a table. In that case, we would have to come up with the Chebyshev filter coefficients using a recursive formula. And here is a recursive formula which relates the ripple in dB eventually to our G0, G1, G2, and G3 parameters. So we could use that. If we're going to be using a computer program to help us select these parameters, that computer program would be using this recursive formula. So in summary, we've arrived at our third order Chebyshev low-pass prototype filter. As shown there, we have the values for that. Now this filter is called a prototype filter. And throughout the development, we will have prototype filters. We just happen to be refining them more and more as we go through. Everything is a prototype filter until we realize the final physical filter. And this is our low-pass prototype filter.